Well, welcome again to North Shore today. It's so good to see all of you who are with us in this room, and I want to say a quick hello to everybody who's joining us online, wherever you're joining us from. Before we dive in, if you were with us last Sunday, Wolfgang opened his message by talking about the eclipse this past week. And it kind of got me thinking about that and events kind of like that. And what kind of a strange person would take off work and get on a plane and travel across the country for something that lasts like 2 minutes? Simple. I would. And I did. In fact, I took my kids. That's right. Nora, Jude, and I spent 12 hours last Sunday traveling across the country to be part of this rather historic astronomical moment. I actually have a picture of us with our eclipse glasses on. There we are. I kind of had to tape those to Jude's head so he wouldn't go blind because he kept kind of pulling them off. But it was this amazing experience. It stopped a Major League Baseball game in Cleveland. It caused air traffic control issues all through the path of totality, if you will. And get this, in Russellville, Arkansas, over 300 couples got married during the totality in a group wedding that was branded Total Eclipse of the Heart. And if you want to know what's wrong with our world, you can just maybe start there. Anyway, there was this kind of strange apocalyptic vibe to it all. I remember this past week, all the news coverage and all the conspiracy theories and all that kind of stuff. But for me, it was just one more piece of evidence that people are searching for something transcendent. People are searching for something meaningful. People are searching for something that's going to connect the dots in a seemingly chaotic, disconnected world, especially in the face of the growing kind of fear and distress that we're seeing around us from politics and the climate and global conflict, all the things happening, escalating right now in the Middle East. And for some of us, it's just the distress we feel around our everyday lives, right? And here's the reality. For a lot of people, going to church or trying to have faith doesn't seem to relieve any of these burdens. In fact, for many people, it just adds this kind of religious layer to those burdens. Like life is already hard enough, and now I've got these rules to follow and these moral expectations to live up to. But here's the thing, friends. This is where we want to dive in with this new series. Jesus did not intend a relationship with him to be a burden in your life. In fact, just the opposite. Listen to these words. These are from the Gospel of Matthew. Sam read a version of this earlier. This is from the Message version, Matthew 11. Jesus says, "Are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Then come to me, get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly." Many of you, if you've been around church, you've heard of the Great Commission. Go and make disciples of all nations. I like to call this the Great Invitation. Come to me, and you'll learn to live not heavy, not burdensome, but freely and lightly. And regardless of your faith background or even what brought you to church this weekend, I believe these words are universally appealing to anybody, everybody. And yet for so many of us, they're completely missing in the experience of our everyday lives. Maybe you came to faith as a child. And on the one hand, faith feels like a very sincere and dear and part of your story, treasured part of your life. But it's also come with all these rules, responsibilities, expectations. Do this, don't do that, avoid this, stop doing that. And your faith, in many ways, has boiled down to a set of obligations that now you have to kind of publicly perform for all the Christians around you that know you're this strong Christian. Or maybe you were raised in a family or a culture or a church that was very shame-based or shame-oriented, and it created kind of a prove-it-or-lose-it mentality when it comes to faith. Want to be saved? Prove it or lose it. Want to be a leader in the church? Prove it or lose it. Want to be forgiven for your sins? Prove it or lose it. Which will create this heavy, burdensome way of trying to follow Jesus in your everyday life. Or maybe you struggle with something like anxiety or depression or something in your mental health, and the idea of God or Christianity doesn't relieve your fears, it just seems to add to them. And I could go on and on with the scenarios that are out there, but the truth is, while it might not be rare to meet a Christian in our day, what's rare is to meet one who's living the kind of life that Jesus was describing in the text we just read. A Christian, a follower of Jesus who's living freely and lightly. A Christian whose spiritual life isn't forced, it's unforced, not driven by obligation or performance for others. A Christian who's not burned out by their faith, but's being restored by it every day, one day at a time. So here's what we're gonna do. Between now and the end of the school year, we're gonna be in this message series called How to Unburden Your Life. And it's rooted in this simple invitation that Jesus said, come to me and keep company with me, and you'll learn to live freely and lightly in your life. And to guide us, we're gonna be walking through a letter in the New Testament called 1 John. And it's all the way back towards the very end of the Bible, if you wanna go there in your Bible now or open your Bible app on your phone. And while there's no actual named author in this letter itself, the earliest historical evidence suggests it was written by the very same John who wrote the Gospel of John and the book of Revelation. So not only did this person know Jesus personally, but he understood the challenges of following Jesus in a world filled with its own apocalyptic fears and distress. But at the heart of this little letter is a verse that you also just heard read to you a moment ago, but it's really the inspiration for this series. John writes these words, "This is love for God, to keep his commands, and his commands are not burdensome." Boy, if I believe that was true. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. His commands are not burdensome, which means today, right now, if your faith, if your approach to walking with God or doing life with Jesus or however you approach becoming a follower of Jesus, if it feels like a burden, an obligation, a set of duties and responsibilities, you've got some relearning to do. And so do I. And that's exactly what this series is gonna be about. So each week we're gonna walk through and unpack a part of this letter. You can start reading through it this week. It's 5 simple chapters. It'll take you less than 30 minutes in one sitting to read the whole book. And with each passage, with each week, we're gonna give you a practice for that week that can help you unburden your life in a practical way. And so it's gonna be really important to be part of every week if you can, whether you're here or you're online. Starting next week with a spiritual practice that is both, I believe, the most needed and most avoided in most of our lives. So that's gonna be next week. But for the rest of our time today, just to tee up this conversation, I want us to talk about kind of the overall goals for a conversation like this. Because here's the reality, just having a conversation like this, if we don't have the right goal, all this stuff that we talk about, it's gonna feel like more and more burdens and responsibilities and stuff you've gotta do to a life that's already probably overly committed and overly busy and all that stuff. So what's the actual goal for this so that it becomes something that relieves our burdens instead of adds to them? So just a few for you to write down just to kick this whole thing off if you're taking notes. First and foremost, the goal isn't more information. The goal is more transformation. And the reason I'm calling this out is because most people, myself included, tend to assess themselves spiritually not based on how transformed they are, but on how informed they are. For example, if I were to think about my own life and try to assess myself from 1 to 10 based on how informed I am about Jesus, I could stand before you and honestly give myself a pretty high number. I mean, I grew up in a Bible teaching church. I have a graduate degree in theology. I've studied ancient Greek and ancient Hebrew. I've spent 20 years preaching scripture in churches. So I should feel pretty good about my faith. I could be a 7 or an 8 or maybe even a 9. But here's the problem. What if I had to do the very same assessment, the very same exercise, not based on how informed I am, but how transformed I am? In other words, how deeply have my everyday thoughts, actions, and attitudes been transformed into what Jesus would think or do if he were me? And I'll be honest with you, assessing myself this way is a little more daunting. But Jesus prayed for his enemies. I like to gossip about mine. Jesus was generous with everything he had. I'd worry so much about my future, I tend to hold on to my stuff. Jesus didn't fall into pride or self-righteousness. I feel overly self-important almost without trying. Quick story, some years ago, I was boarding an airplane and there was a woman in the aisle in front of me. Many of you have been in a moment like this, who was trying to get her bag up into the overhead bin. And she was really taking her time and there was a line kind of building up behind her. And without thinking, I felt this sense of impatience sort of well up in my spirit. Anyone ever felt impatience well up in your spirit with somebody else, right? And it quickly kind of devolved into this sense of frustration and anger. I mean, I had nowhere to go. We're all on the same plane. But I was frustrated. I was angry. I started giving her this look like, you're wasting my time and you're ruining my morning. Some of you know this look. You're giving it to me right now. I can see it in your faces, right? So I finally decide the only way I'm going to get to my seat is to help her with her bag. So for totally selfish reasons, I say, can I help you with your bag? And she looked at me and said, no kidding, hey, you're the pastor of my church. And I said, yes, I am. And then what I was thinking was, clearly I'm not a very good one, but yes, I am. So how does that score on a scale of 1 to 10? Well, informed, I'm still a 7, 8, 9 informed about Jesus, but transformed looks a little different. You see, it's quite possible, and this is so true in the church in our day, it's quite possible to be very well informed about Jesus and not be so transformed by Jesus. And I'm not the only person in this room that has this problem. See, churches today are filled with people who could tell you lots of things that Jesus said, but who actually don't know how to live very much like how he lived. And again, I'm not saying that what Jesus said doesn't matter or we don't need to learn more about him or the Bible. We're going to dive deep into the scripture in the series, and I hope you learn things that you didn't know before as we go through it. But the goal isn't more information. The goal is more transformation. That's first. Here's a second one for you as we walk through this. The goal of this series isn't spiritual activity for Jesus. The goal is relational intimacy with Jesus. So again, the goal is not more activity, more stuff to do. The goal is actually greater closeness and intimacy with Jesus. Listen to how John opens this letter. This is 1 John 1, verse 1. He says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared, and we've seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard so that you may also have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we write this to make our joy complete. Notice John begins this conversation talking about a personal, relational experience of Jesus. It's all about fellowship with Jesus. That's what makes joy complete. Jesus is someone that he's seen and heard and touched with his hands. Now, the point isn't that they were able to have an experience personally with Jesus that we can't. The point is that the goal of being a disciple is actually just being with Jesus. I want to say that again because I actually think we get this like a lot very confused about this. The goal of being a disciple is actually just being with Jesus. And everything Jesus taught his followers to do is about helping us grow closer to Jesus relationally, especially for those of us who live after he lived and cannot be with him in person the way that they could. The problem is many of us, if not most of us, turn the practices, the activities, the actions or the teaching of Jesus, if you will, into the goal itself. In other words, we turn prayer into the goal. We turn reading the Bible into the goal. We turn things like fasting into the goal. And those are good things, and we're going to talk about those in a moment. But friends, let me just tell you right now, those are not the goal. They're just the means of to getting to the real goal, which is greater intimacy with the person of Jesus. Let me try to illustrate this with another example to see if this makes sense. I've become a pretty avid runner over the past few years, but I have to tell you, when I first started running, I absolutely hated doing it. I hated the thought of it. I didn't want to do it. I talked myself out of it morning after morning after morning because I thought the goal was just running. But here's the thing. The secret that's helped me fall in love with running is realizing the goal of running is not running. Running is just the means. It's how I get to the goal. The goal, it's lots of other things. The goal is better health. The goal is the release of those cool endorphins in my brain that decrease stress and build confidence. The goal, how about this one? The goal is getting away for an hour away from my children, who I love, but sometimes just drive me crazy, right? Running is not the goal. It's just a way to get there. And the same is true with all the practices and disciplines, the ways Jesus taught us to live. They're not the goal, they're just the way to get there. Let's take fasting for example, because for most people, fasting sounds less appealing than even running, right? Jesus practiced fasting, we know that. He taught his disciples about fasting, we know that. But fasting was never the goal. In fact, when he was on earth with them, his disciples didn't fast like the other first century Jews. And when people ask why, Jesus said these words. Check this out. He said, how can the guests of the bridegroom fast while he is what? With them. They cannot so long as they have him what? With them. But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them, and on that day they will fast. In other words, fasting is only necessary when we're not fully present with Jesus. Therefore, it is simply a way, a means, a method to remind ourselves that God is actually more satisfying than food, or more satisfying than screens, or more satisfying than success, or more satisfying than pleasure. And so we fast, not as if it's the goal or the point or the purpose, but simply as a means of experiencing the provision of Jesus, the faithfulness of Jesus, the sustaining power of Jesus. And the same is true when it comes to confession and forgiveness and reading the Bible. These practices are really important, but they're not the goal. They're how we get to it. Are you with me so far? Is this making sense? The problem is when we get this backwards, when we take a spiritual practice and we make it the goal and we evaluate ourselves based on how we're doing at that goal, guess what happens? We burn out and we give up, just like you do when you're planning to run. And that's why most of us don't fast or pray or spend time in scripture, because we think that's the goal. I just got to be in the Bible for an hour. That just sounds boring to me. But the goal isn't spiritual activity, it's deeper intimacy with Jesus. And that's the goal of this entire conversation, this entire series we're gonna walk through. Not information, but transformation. Not activity, but intimacy. And then one more goal for this series, if you're taking notes, wanna write this down. The goal is not to prove your faith. The goal is to grow your faith. I've been thinking about this idea a lot recently, and a mentor of mine raised it with me just a few days ago. And what we were talking about is how this idea that for so many followers of Jesus in our day, we can approach our faith almost like a form of karma. We think, for example, if I just do enough good things, God will protect me from bad things, right? Ever had that thought? Or if I just prove how faithful I can be, God will give me the life I want, right? Sound about right? Which is really just a kind of Christianized version of karma. And what God has been revealing to me recently is how much this kind of thinking has been driving my behavior and my actions and my attitudes, which also leads to a kind of spiritual burnout. But here's the thing, if you are a follower of Jesus, you don't need to prove anything ever, ever. Listen to how John described the very reasons he wrote 1 John. This is from chapter 2, verse 12. He says, I am writing to you, dear children, because your sins have been forgiven on account of his name. I'm writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I'm writing to you, young men, because you've overcome the evil one already. I write to you, dear children, because you know the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God lives you, and you have overcome the evil one already. What's all this mean? It means that whether you're new to faith or you've been walking with Jesus for a long time, your sins are already forgiven. The enemy's already defeated. You are strong and God's word lives in you. And Jesus hasn't changed since day one, which means you don't have to prove anything. You don't have to prove anything to me, to the person next to you, anybody else in the church. You don't have to prove your faith. Friends, the goal is to grow it. What a gift. I don't have to stand here and prove myself to you. My job every day, like yours, is to grow my trust and grow my faith and grow my confidence in God. And walking through pain or difficulty isn't a sign that you failed at your faith, which is what Christian karma will tell you. What did you do wrong? How did you mess up? When did you not believe? It's not a sign that you failed in your faith. It's another opportunity to what? To grow your trust, to grow your faith. And actually, even in those difficult moments, find greater freedom from the burdens you're carrying, even right now. I loved how a writer named Dallas Willard once put it. I love this. He said, the main thing God gets out of your life is not the achievements you accomplish, it's the person you become. You see, friends, you can build the best resume in the world and still carry the heaviest burdens. You can do all the right things according to the Bible and still carry the heaviest burdens. Because success doesn't unburden your life, money doesn't unburden your life, fame doesn't unburden your life, getting married doesn't unburden your life, having children, boy howdy, that doesn't unburden your life, right? These are all good things. They're all great gifts. They cannot unburden your life. Only Jesus can, and only practicing the way of Jesus with Jesus can, no matter what the circumstances. I'll close with a story. There's a writer named Tom Schmidt who used to volunteer in a convalescent home near where he went to college. And he describes it as a place he never really wanted to go. And he always felt relief when he left until the day that he met a woman named Mabel. And he would later write about meeting Mabel this way. These are his words that he wrote, just so you know, that's what this description comes from. He said, her face was a horror. The empty stare and white pupils of her eyes told me that she was blind. The large hearing aid over one ear told me that she was almost deaf. One side of her face was being eaten by cancer. There was a discolored and running sore covering part of one cheek that had pushed her nose to one side, dropped one eye, and distorted her jaw so that what should have been the corner of her mouth was actually the bottom of her mouth. As a consequence, she drooled constantly. I also later learned that this woman was 89 years old and she'd been here bedridden, blind, nearly deaf, and alone for 25 years. But in spite of her appearance, Tom began to speak with and meet with and talk with Mabel. And he quickly began to realize that this was no ordinary human being. He described what happened this way. He said, Mabel and I became friends. I went to see her once or twice a week for the next 3 years. Some days I would read to her from her beloved Bible. And often when I would pause, she would continue reciting the passage from memory, word for word. On other days, I would take a book of hymns and sing with her, and she would know all the words of the old songs. For Mabel, these were not merely exercises in memory. She would often stop mid-hymn and make a brief comment about the lyrics she considered particularly relevant to her own situation. It was not many weeks before I turned from a sense that I was being helpful to a sense of wonder. And I would go to her with a pen and paper and write down the things she would say. One time I asked her, Mabel, what do you think about when you lie here? And she said, I think about Jesus. And I sat there and thought, these are his words, for a moment about the difficulty for me of thinking about Jesus, even for 5 minutes. And I asked, what do you think about Jesus? And she said, I think about how good he's been to me. He's been awfully good to me, you know, she said. I'm one of those people who's mostly satisfied. I'd rather have Jesus. He's all the world to me. And then Tom writes this. He said, this is not fiction. As credible as it may seem, a human being really lived like this. I know. I knew her. I watched her for 3 years. How could she do it? Seconds ticked and minutes crawled. And so did days and weeks and months and years of pain without human company and without an explanation of why it was all happening. And she lay there and sang hymns. How could she do it? How could someone with so many burdens live such an unburdened life? And the answer, he said, is that Mabel had something that you and I don't have much of. She had power. Lying in that bed, unable to move, unable to see, unable to hear, unable to talk to anyone, she had incredible power. Power that comes from being with Jesus. And here's the good news in all this, friends. There is nothing in your life, no person, no circumstance, no situation that can prevent you from being with Jesus. Not sickness or suffering, not darkness or depression, which is why the goal of the series, really the goal of everything we do, is to prioritize how can we just be with Jesus? And by being with him, learning how to live more freely and lightly, even in the most difficult circumstances. But first, and here's my challenge for you as we kick off this conversation. This is kind of your homework for the week. My challenge for you and the question for you is, what's the real goal for you? Like, why are you here today? Why are you doing any of this? Why do you open your Bible when you open it? Why do you pray when you pray? Why do you sit here for an hour when you come and sit here for an hour? Is it to grow closer to Jesus? Or is Jesus just a means to another end? Like an improved life or better circumstances? You see, the great choice we have, and the choice I want to challenge you to make in the quiet of your heart right now, is whether or not you really want to choose just being with Jesus. Like, if I had to let go of everything else, like, I'd choose Jesus. Because even though life may be filled with burdens, and your life today may be filled with even the greatest burdens, Jesus isn't. And being with him isn't. And so we're going to take a moment just to reflect on that choice right now. So if you close your eyes, bow your heads, just for a moment. We're going to pray, and we're going to sing one last song that's really part of the prayer today. It's something I want us to prayerfully sing and offer as our response to this question. What are you going to choose? Who are you going to choose? Are you going to accept the great invitation today? Come. Come away with Jesus. Get away with him. And he will help you recover your life and unburden your soul. And so, Jesus, we want to respond by saying yes to you right now. I want to confess that on so many days, in so many moments, I choose you for what I think you're going to give me or what I want you to protect in my life, that you're the means to a different end instead of the goal itself. And so I just want to confess that even now. Jesus, help me in this moment choose you as the great goal, the greatest goal, the only goal of life. There is no greater goal, no worthier goal, no worthier life pursuit than following you and being with you in every moment and in every way, just like Mabel. And so help us do that right now. Jesus, give me more of your life. Give me more of your life as we pray and as we worship. And it's your name we pray.